dust. It comes in many sizes. My moon buddy knows them all with his dirty money. He collected it in my workshop. Chips from the planer, dust from the punch cut saw, normal dust you can find in your house, baking flour, and sugar. Maybe he is hungry after his trip to space.
Ruud hier, checking in for all of you who are eagerly waiting on a scientific test video of the centrifugal dust separator. So if you only watch to see test footage, please skip to the last part of this video. And when you're interested into the journey of design and making things, then let's dive in. In the last video, I ended up with the separator hanging on the wall, with the base plate and the dust bins installed. And many of you were disappointed that I didn't show the test of the separator in that video. And in my mind, I already did a test run of 35 minutes on my planer. That was the very first video I dropped on this channel back in June.
It's fair to say that it was a quick test, and there was nothing scientific about it. For me, it was proof though that the concept was more than working fine for my purpose with the separation above 99%. It made the difference in cleaning the chem vac once every 20 minutes to once every 30 run hours.
Only my curiosity started to hunt on me, and I wanted to find out the exact efficiency number upon the last decimal, and squeeze out even more. The focus was on building a new test setup in my studio. That's why I bought this new triple mode chem vac, to be able to test with higher powers. And I wanted to be able to weigh the dust amount inside the chem vac without the need to open it every time. So the creative process started in my brain and made its way to the workbench.
The chem vac with the triple motors has a weight of 20 kilograms. And the scale that I use has a weight limit of 5 kilograms, with the accuracy of 0.1 gram. So I need to build some kind of lever design to reduce the weight by 5.
Building a test setup is great when you know what and how to test, because dust comes in different sizes, shapes, densities, and speeds. In front of me, I collected 4 types of dust you all will recognize. These large ones are shavings from a planer. These are sawdust from a punch cut saw. This is flour and sugar that you only will use in your coffee or tea, hope. The flour is almost the same as fine sanding dust that is sticky and extra fine. I made piles of them, each 1 kilogram. And these 2 piles are 250 gram.
Hey, you're back. Come, show us the size differences. This is a planer shaving made by a spiral cutter head. It's big and curly. These are dust shavers for my punch cut saw. And this is regular dust that I found in my house. It contains many cotton fiber. Here you can see baking flour bounded together. This is crystal, you all know. It's sugar, sweet. And on top of it, a pinch of baking flour.
Now we have a better feeling by the different kinds of dust and how the sizes compare to each other. There is an important thing to consider though for the testing phase, because tools produces dust at each another rate, in kilograms an hour. My planer produces 6 to 7 kilograms at continuous feeding rate. The bandsaw produces a lot of fine dust because of the small teeth in the blade. And I don't have any exact numbers on that, because it's just arrived. So, I think it's time now to find a way to mount the chem vac on the cleat wall and guide the weight
into the lever device. And I want to speed build it without any CAD work. I had some drawer slides laying on the shelf because I bought them for my floating TV cabinet and changed them to invisible bloom slides. For the base, I tried to use as much as scrap wood as possible. These were the base plate from the prototype that was way too heavy. Every clean workshop has scrap laying around that are a good use for building projects to test things out. My studio is small and the tools are only two steps away. I try to keep it organized to be able to focus on the projects and not on the search for the tools. I try to make use of scrap woods laying around with parallel edges to act as spacing templates for easy installation of the slides. For me, the speed build projects are an excellent way to relax after a day of computer work with only the sound of tools. Trusting the hands to problem solve their way out of every mistake they make, because they already made a lot of them in the past and have learned from it, or not. The process of my design is making mistake after mistake, just to start building, bringing things to life, and trying not to take care about the failures. Some of them are very obvious at one point. You, for example, would comment that the lever device will fail big time. Only because two reasons. One, you already made the same mistake in the past and remembered that it was a mistake. So you know how to fix it, make a better version, or use a complete different approach that is more effective. Two, your more experienced skill set made you see it sooner than me that it is a mistake or would turn out into one. And that is what I like about YouTube and sharing experiences. To learn faster than I would do on my own and become a better maker. It's all my hands though that need to make the mistakes themselves to remember it for longer. A sort of muscle memory. Most times I dislike the use of fast-forward footage on YouTube. I work my way around them a lot. Now I use it myself to make a little point of the speed building aspect and dramatize it a bit. So let's slow down. I mount the canvas guide to the wall and fixate it with some shims. You notice that I cut corners as much as possible to make fast progress. In this stage of design, it's key to build fast and let the hands do the work. It's not an art or science project, just a proof of concept to test the feasibility of this idea. I will soon find out that the physics taught on school eliminates friction for 99% of the time, and why that makes the build a failure and complete waste of time. You see me use a round piece of wood that is borrowed from a cup game that I use a lot as spacing blocks in my shop. The rounded pieces make sure that the force is distributed over a line and not on a flat surface. First, let's find out if the scale is really accurate at 0.1 grams. I put multiple times my cordless drill on it to see what the readout is. It seems pretty convincing. Now let's see what the results the lever device gives us. And it is bad. Friction in the system takes it over, and readouts are not repeatable at all. Also, leaning on the work surface affects the readout. Now let's see if it holds the weight of the canvas. So, that's a lot of flex.
Sometimes I walk too long around with my engineering hat, trying to solve the problem.
Your drawer slides are not positioned in the right way. Mount them sideways for less flex. Or use your CNC rails. They are in the upper Euro box. The real solution is far more simple. A calculator is overkill to do the math, but it's YouTube after all. What I try to achieve here is just not feasible, because separation of 99% and above will result in 10 grams or less sawdust that passes through to the CamVac for each kilogram of processed material. And the CamVac and slider device thing is a total of 25 kilograms. That is 25,000 grams. Divide that by 10 grams and you know. Now we made the most complicated hook possible that is not stable at all, but we're just going to use it for the dust test with the separator. For this video, I explain my test process with sugar. First, I weigh the starting weight and subtract the empty bin weight from it, if needed, for the larger dust volumes. Then I spread it evenly out in a gutter. I turn on the motors that are needed for the test and let the hose determine the speed. In orange, I calculated the mass flow rate at kilogram an hour by checking the time that the material is processed. In blue, the speed of the video when it is in fast forward. The sugar was heavy and the airflow wasn't capable to reach all the sharp corners of the gutter. This time I only weighed the bins before and after the test. The difference is added together and compared with the starting weight. The sugar and the flour are suggested by one of you down in the comments. Flour is a really difficult product that likes to bound together. Chunks of flour are being sucked in, and the flour in the corners of the gutter are difficult to remove at the first time. In the separator it is immediately clear that it's not being removed properly and it is overflowing the second stage. A kind of sand dunes are created in the tube and they will not disappear out of themselves. This test was done with two motors enabled and cleaning it was such a struggle that I had to take it apart and rinse it with water. Compressed air alone was not enough, so I never took the guts to test it with three motors. The flex hose collected a lot of flour and the flour dunes are clearly visible. Maybe the outlet walls needed to be straightened at both sides for a better path down to the bins for this kind of dust. The seals did a great job. Looking back to the footage, I think that for this type of dust, the impeller could have a larger blocked inner diameter to narrow down the area where the blades are located, so the airspeed will increase. Between testing, I printed a new adapter for the flex hose. It can be screwed into and fits the Y piece. Make sure you connect your flex hose in the right orientation. The airflow needs to follow the arrow. For the sawdust and the planar shavings, I present it to you in a different way. Each tube is a different motor setup, so you can compare it yourself. The mass flow rates are important to know while testing. For example, the mass flow rate of my hammer, A31 Technischer Planer, is around 6 to 7 kilograms per hour at continuous feed rate. I noticed that there's a slight difference between the left and the right tube, depending on the flex hose position. So for the best results, there should be a larger straight tube between the Y piece and the inlet. This way the flow has less turbulence when it reaches the first stage. I did not test this theory yet, Only it's an interesting thing to test in the future. When you look up close and already built my separator yourself, you should notice that this test uses a slightly different shroud design, with some more body.
Let's make a brief overview of the test results. I will need my notes for that, and I show them to you briefly on screen. So the baking flour was a complete disaster. It did 64%, and I needed to clean out the damn thing outside with water. The sourdust was about 88 to 92%. 88 was with two motors, and the 92% was with three motors active on the triple motor CanVac. The shavings of the planer did about 98%. To 99, and the sugar was the best with 99.0%. I was a bit disappointed though, because in June I did a test on my planer with a scale that was accurate for 1 gram, and I came out on 99.6%. So the feed rate is very important in the testing results. And maybe the PVC version is a little bit better than the acrylic one. If you made it this far, I had made you a promise that I will spoil you on the next project. I have bought two of these bad boys that will going to replace the CanVac that I'm going to install above the planer. And this will need to house the fine particle dust filters in it. And it will be a transparent housing. I need to build it from scratch, so I take you along in that journey without looking back on projects that I already did. I really appreciate your thoughts and ideas about this project or the upcoming one. So leave them down in the comments, and I hope to see you in the next video. Thank you for watching. Houdoe!